See, it's again the mass India goes and researches about things which they are interested about. Nobody can actually be excited about, excited naturally about the canvas they are in. Okay, these Indian classical dances are available at our disposal in the nearest temple or in the nearest function. So it's never something which we need to go in search of. So we take it for granted. I knew that good quality dances happen in various small pockets across the world. But, you know, I never knew that it's taken to a level that, you know, the same problem we faced with yoga and all this, where people have started practicing it more dedicatedly outside India. After interacting with Shastram and Girija, I kind of have this feeling that after a point of time, if you want quality teachers or quality way of education in terms of Indian classical dances, there could be a time later on people would have to fly abroad to do it, because there is a flexibility of time, there's a flexibility of wavelength, there's a flexibility of doing two, three, things simultaneously, the rigidity is lesser. So I think after a point of time, when students in India who want to specialize in Indian classical dance would probably want to go abroad and learn it. Because looking at what, you know, each country is trying to, you know, do towards this art form, it looks like we are still stuck to a few rigid rules.
Indian dancing in Chennai, of course, it's unmatched, because this is the Mecca of Bharatanatyam. Having said that, it doesn't mean that because it's the Mecca of Bharatanatyam, everybody is brilliant dancers here. You have got, it boils down once again to good dancing and bad dancing. Chennai is the hub, and you have the best of resources here in terms of musicians, in terms of resource people, scholars, percussionists and so on. So you get the best of all that to formulate the dance, or form the dance, and to preserve the dance. But of course, on the flip side, you've got the entire Sabha culture, which is brilliant on the one hand, but can be annoying on the other hand. So it's a bit of a mix of both. And it's virtually impregnable by people who come from outside, unless you're willing to pay the Sabhas to perform. And so there's all that Sabha culture that goes with, you know, paying for a program to basically get your work to be shown or get famous. So there is all of that there happening at that one time. But today, I think the media, social media like YouTube and Facebook and stuff like that, you get to put your work there, and it's seen the world over. Like one of our works has been viewed, like yesterday I was surprised to see 60,000 views so far. So that was, it's like if you were to dance to a 1,000 capacity audience, you've done that program 60 times. So, you know, it's, and it's over time, people would have reviewed that same program again on YouTube. So YouTube and Facebook have become platforms or venues for the art form to shine. So it's shifted. And then again, location does not mean anything today. Chennai, you have the dances. What about a town like Tuttukudi, or a small town like Tiruchendur or Madurai for that matter? And then you find a very brilliant dancer coming from LA and from Tokyo and then from London. And so you've got brilliant dancers around the world. So Bharatanatyam, it may have germinated in the temples of the south, of South India, of Tamil Nadu, but then it's obviously like reached different heights, different levels of performance, different corners of the globe. So it's just like sprouted and grown. So it's interesting to see the way it's grown. I don't think the Devadasis in the last the century before, would have even thought that their dance form is going to go to the corners of the world. I don't think they would have even thought that. Especially when they were considered taboo at some point in time.
Art form in India is now an extracurricular activity. It's not a curricular activity. It's still what you do in the mainstream career as such. Can you take up dance and support yourself? Can you take up painting and support yourself? There are still parents who are worried about, you know, taking up specialized courses for their, you know, selecting specialized courses for their children, because it is not having a certain pattern saying, okay, you finish this course, you will go join a job, you will get a monthly salary of so much. So even now, I personally know so many brilliant dancers, so many brilliant musicians, so many brilliant artists who've gone into the mainstream professions like engineering or IT or ITES, any of these, because that's where the money comes on a regular basis, on a monthly basis. Now, starting from the parent, even to the student, you know, he wants to have all the comforts of life because there is so much available now that he cannot say that, okay, I am going to dedicate myself only to acting or only to performing arts and limit my lifestyle. So when this is what is required out of you, how do you actually go and dedicate yourself to one particular art form or learning it in that particular pattern? So it's become an extracurricular activity. So in the foundation stage, when that is what it is, you cannot expect much from the result. I have to really tell you how big this country is. Okay, I don't know how to go about explaining it, but probably I can give you an insight from my personal experience. I used to do a lot of documentaries for the government, okay? And we used to do these really mundane documentaries about the work the government of India has done in the ruralist part of India. And when I go on these journeys, I've been to the most ruralist part of India, and I've seen them building small stuffs, like, you know, growing a vegetable garden for a farmer, from farmer's wife, or building a bathroom in a few houses in the remotest part. To get to that place, it will take you at least 2 hours or 3 hours of, you know, non-conventional transport. Okay, so it is a huge country. It's a huge country. So change happens, but happens in pockets. And when change happens, it's not shown that much outside, but there are people in all parts of the country who have taken up this as a job, as a passion, to go ahead and try to do something about it. If it doesn't work here, they go abroad and do something about it. Because one, they have financial independence. They can handle a part-time job to support their basic needs and then take care of their passion. So that's possible more abroad. So they move. So wherever you see, there is a certain amount of Indian influence in everything. So if you're talking about a Malaysian school, or if you're talking about an Australian school, there is a certain percentage of Indians who are supporting it, at least by buying tickets, at least by watching the show, at least by practicing it. So it's not that the present generation of India have nothing to do with their knowledge, which they have. It's happening. But it's not so widely popularized or widely, you know, spread about, because I don't know, probably, you know, because they have a certain perspective that when they want to come out, they want to come out big. So they're going on that process. So right now, say for the past 10 or 15 years is when this whole, you know, my culture, my knowledge, all these kind of informations have been highlighted only for the past 10 or 15 years. Before that, we were trying to come out of the whole, you know, image people have of India, saying, you know, developing nation or underdeveloped nation. So we've been, given the impression through our educational system that we are a developing nation or an underdeveloped nation. India is no more about survival, or the present generation of Indians are not about survival. That survival struggle we had about 50 or 60 years ago. We were trying to survive. So we had to leave our culture aside. We have to leave our ethics aside. We have to leave our knowledge aside and just pass it on without even having knowledge. A lot of things which we think is superstition might not have been superstition, because if we had the time to actually, you know, explain the information behind those superstitions, you would probably have a logical answer to most of these stuffs. But so we are no more surviving. Now we want to live the high life. Now we want to make a lot of money. Now we want to have a job security. It's no more unemployment. There is job available in plenty. If you want to earn this much amount of X amount of money, you can go work in a shop which is right next to your house. If you want X amount of money, you can do this. So there are options now. So there is not much of unemployment in this particular segment I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the uneducated or the people who are, you know, having no access to this particular, environment. I'm talking about the majority of the people who live in the cities. Their perspective is no more survival. Their perspective is live better. So when that comes about, it is very difficult to say that, okay, I will do a job which is going to give me just enough to make my ends meet. I know so many people who are brilliantly talented, who are doctors, who have learned dancing for 14 years, 16 years, all through their growing up age. They become a doctor. And after that, you know, their profession takes up most of their life. And where do they find the time to practice what they love most? Because that's not going to give them the bread and butter now. Because their bread and butter expectation is a certain amount of money. So that way, you know, we're no more trying to survive. We're trying to live better. Thank you.